Hey guys, this is John Carroll here again with another episode of Forward Talk. Thank you for joining us today. And today we have a very special guest with us, Demetrius Miner. He is a preacher and an author and also a political, cultural, and religious commentator. He is also a member of Project 21 News. Can you take a moment to tell our audience what Project 21 is?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, Pastor Carroll, thank you for having me on the program to talk about some very important critical issues. Project 21 is a network of conservative African-American leaders across the country who offer commentary on cultural, on current events that deals from a cultural, racial, and political perspective. And so our commentaries are frequently seen on news outlets such as Fox News, CNN, ABC, or sometimes written commentary such as Town Hall or just various news outlets across the country where we try to offer a conservative perspective to today's current events.
There are a number of Black conservative organizations in America. What makes Project 21 unique to some of the other Black conservative groups that are out there?
Well, because Project 21 is actually a component of a nationally known think tank known as the National Center for Public Policy and Research.
Okay.
So that sort of sets us apart from the other entities across the United States.
Well, that's awesome. And of course, we are wanting today to talk about some very important issues that are happening in our country and our culture at this very moment. And if anybody has the least bit of public cultural social awareness, they know what's going on in the world right now.
Correct.
Let's just start with what the big thing that's in the news and everybody's mind right now, and that is the unnecessary, absolute, unjustifiable death of George Floyd.
Yes, sir.
Can you just speak to that for just a moment? I mean, the optics of that officer kneeling in his neck with his knee for however many minutes it was is heartbreaking. It's awful. And anybody that can see that video, hear George Floyd's panic and voice, and even still photos of that officer just chilling there on his neck with his hands in his pocket, like, you know, he's just hanging out, is just, it's awful.
It is gut-wrenching. And the optics for many have become the reality. And that's also what's frustrating, sad, and maddening all at the same time. It's a confluence of emotions that have been running through my mind. When I saw that video, to hear someone say that they can't breathe, they don't have air, they don't have oxygen, his plea for help, to think of the family that he left behind. It's heart-wrenching. That's the best way to describe it. Pastor, I have not been able to sleep. I've been tossing and turning, not just because of that event, but the event that followed that, the Ahmaud Arbery case, and just the response of the nation, the problem of race that we still have to confront in the year 2020, what it means for me, what it means for my generation, what it would mean for the generation that will come after me, what it means for the church and how we should amplify our voices.
Yes,
against,
sir.
Racism, against hatred, against bigotry, and of course just anger at the enemy that is trying to tear our country apart, that is trying to tear our families apart. And, you know, you're a pastor, you know the word of God. The Bible says that upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So we know that the church will ultimately be victorious. But what the enemy is after, he is after our families, he is after our communities, he is after our nation. And it's a sobering reminder, Pastor, that we really don't have that much time.
And the only way that any of us should be speaking to these issues is from a perspective of the gospel. We have to speak the gospel to it.
Yes, sir.
There's no way. I mean, you're a member of a Black conservative constituency in America. I'm more actually libertarian than I am conservative. But
I don't blame you.
I'm more libertarian than I am conservative, but it's that's irrelevant. There is no Republican. There is no Republican Congress or Senate or President, Democrat, Congress, Senate, or President. No other party is going to be able to fix the problems that are confronting our country. In fact, our politicians are merely a reflection of our nation's moral fabric and heart. We elect leaders after our own heart. And so it's really not the fault of politicians. Politicians are merely reflecting the sickness of America's hearts as in general. And so, but the only way that we are going to be able to fix this is to preach and speak the gospel to our world.
I concur across social media platforms, Twitter to be specific. I see a lot of posts and a lot of status about America needs a president.
Yeah.
No, that's not what America needs.
America needs a savior.
Because you just said politics is a reflection of culture. Culture is a reflection of society. Society is a reflection of what we allow ourselves to tolerate.
Yeah.
And America needs the saving gospel of Jesus Christ. There's so many things that fascinates me about Jesus, but one of the things that really catches my attention is that everywhere that he went, Pastor, he met their needs.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Met it with compassion. And I think that's something that the church has a moral obligation to do, and something that we can do better. I'm reminded of Luke 14.
I like that point that you just made there. Nobody can speak to the culture in the way that the body of Christ can, if we will do it.
Correct. If we will do it, yeah.
Nobody has the moral grounding, the moral authority to speak to the culture the way the church does. But we have to do it, and we have to do it well.
Yes, sir. We have to be willing to listen.
Yes, sir.
Former President George W. Bush came out with a statement yesterday against talking about George Floyd. And he said something that really stuck out to me, and I believe this is applicable to the church. He says, we have to be willing to listen and not lecture. And I think so many times we want to lecture people on how they should feel, on how they should act. And even if we can't relate to them, even if we can't understand the pain,
even
if we ourselves have never experienced the pain, that's okay. But we should still have the ability and the desire to empathize.
Yes, sir.
To listen and to have an open heart and an open mind. And when people see that you empathize with their struggle and with their plight, then we're going to be able to be persuasive in our desire to grow the kingdom of God.
And it's easy for many of us to, and I say, man, I hate having to even speak in this kind of way. I wish there was a world in which there was no us and them, but unfortunately, we do live in a world where there is an us and you.
Right.
It shouldn't be that way, but in a fallen world, that is the sad reality. But for many of my white friends, it's so easy to, and I hate those terms too. I'm not going to get into the technicalities of why I don't like those terms, but I don't like the term black. I don't like the term white. But that's kind of the language that's understood in the culture. So I'm going to use it today without making a big deal out of it. But it's easy for many of my white friends to just say, well, they shouldn't have been resisting arrest, or they shouldn't have been, doing whatever led to the conflict with the police. And I don't even know if it's true, but in the case of George Floyd, there's reports that says he was high, that before this video, he was resisting arrest. And it's easy for us to just dismiss those kinds of deaths at the hands of the police by just saying, well, they shouldn't have been doing what they were doing in the first place. And one of the best takes I've seen on the George Floyd situation from a Christian perspective was Jeff Durbin of Apologia Church in Arizona. And he made the incredible point that if all of those things were true, even if he was high, even if he was resisting arrest, even if he was writing hot checks or whatever the narrative is that people are spinning about his situation, that none of those things deserve the death penalty.
Correct. And one of the troubling things, as you just alluded to it, is that individuals put up a defense mechanism. When we talk about police brutality, when we talk about racial issues, and as you said, people tend to bring up someone's past as if that negates the reason for them being killed.
Yeah,
I think about that from a Christian perspective, and we're always eager to sing about, to preach about God's grace and God's mercy.
Exactly.
What if God was to withhold his grace and his mercy because we committed this particular sin, or we committed this particular act? What if God was to say, okay, I am done with showing grace and mercy, and I'm going to give you what you deserve? I think we all will be singing a very different tune.
Well, I think the reason why it's so easy for many of us for many of us to conceptualize or to see a world in which perhaps George Floyd kind of deserved the thing that he got is because too often we do conceptualize God as that God who has a knee in our neck because we messed up, or because we have these things that we deal with that we have not yet come to terms with. And so God is heavy-handed, and God is this extreme God of justice. And so we kind of, I think often, at least in the segment of Christianity of Pentecost that I grew up in, we kind of view God as a God who is very willing to do kind of the image that we saw that police officer.
I would definitely agree that at times we do have a misconstrued perception of God in his sovereignty, in how he views humanity.
Yes, we do.
He has a love for all humanity. He died for all humanity.
Yes, he did.
Which is why we have to have these conversations. Because if we truly call ourselves Christians, which encompasses being Christ-like, that means we have to love our fellow man just as we love ourselves.
That's right.
Love your neighbor as you love yourself.
Yes,
and so how you view people of a different culture, of a different race, of a different background. A lot of times it's not just race. A lot of times there's biases against people from different economical backgrounds or depending on their class structure in society.
Exactly.
But how we view them is also a reflection of how we view ourselves and how we view Christ. How we view and how we treat the vulnerable, the weak, in the marginalized.
Absolutely.
The Bible says, what you have done unto the least of these, you have also done it unto me. Pastor, that's a pretty direct and straightforward model of what Christianity should look like.
It absolutely should be. And I'm in a class right now at Regent University. We are in a class on the study of the prophets. And the first 4 weeks of the class, part of our reading assignments has been to read the book of Isaiah.
Yes.
And when reading the book of Isaiah,
especially Isaiah 59.
Yeah.
Very powerful.
Yeah. Reading the book of Isaiah, the bulk of the message of Isaiah is God speaking to the injustice that existed in Israel with the yes. fatherless and the widows and the marginalized and those that that were not able to protect and cover themselves, and spoke strongly against the oppressors and those who were taking advantage of those that were unfortunate. And so speaking up for the oppressed and against the oppressors is a huge part of the message of the Bible and the message of the Old Testament. And when you quote the words of Jesus, as you have done unto the least of these, you have done it unto me. Jesus is carrying on that, pulling into the Old Testament the New Testament, that Old Testament motif of justice.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And we must do the same.
We have to.
We must call for not just justice, but there also has to be accountability.
Yes.
To ensure that the instances like happened with George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, Eric yes. Garner, the list goes on.
Yeah.
To ensure that these
Eric Garner was the black man in New York, right?
Of course, it also said he couldn't breathe, to make sure that these instances doesn't happen again. Because Pastor, let me tell you what's happening. Black Americans, they don't even have the opportunity to mourn one tragedy
until another one,
because they're happening in rapid succession. And I condemn violence. I condemn looting.
We're going to get there in just a moment, because
okay. yeah, there's a reason why all that's happening. But there, with justice also comes accountability.
Absolutely.
With law enforcement, through the court system, the list goes on.
At somewhere, a police officer is going to have to get the proper punishment, the proper whatever the terminology is, the proper sentencing, the proper in order for this to stop. Too often that these things happen, and the most that an officer gets is a slap on the wrist. Too often they just get fired, and they still keep their pension. They still keep their retirement. They still keep everything. And so there has been, at least that the media has made us aware of, there hasn't been that much, very many instances at all of an officer that has committed this type of abuse that's lost anything significant that will deter other officers from committing these particular acts of violence.
And here's the truth, Pastor. If this wasn't caught on film,
yeah, this would not be.
We wouldn't be talking about. We wouldn't have known. We wouldn't have been aware. And there's a strong possibility that police officer would have gotten off and went about his day-to-day life.
It would have just been. He was resisting arrest. His word against their word.
Correct.
And the system was going to side with the word of the officer and.
Correct.
You know, chances are he probably wouldn't have got more than a couple of days off work while they looked into the circumstance or the
correct.
Event. Correct. And so there has to be accountability. You are exactly right there. We have to reach a place to where we are holding officers accountable for their actions. And I hope everybody will say that. I hope we're willing to say as Christians that. This is more than just a black and white issue. I think, and there is that component that's real, but I think the greatest crime that happened with with George Floyd, with the other cases, Eric Garner, the other cases that you mentioned. This is the, sadly, we're not even really even, at least that I see, we're not even talking about the other names. George Floyd has kind of become the name that we're using. That we've kind of centralized everything on his name. Is that this was a divine image bearer. This was someone who carries the image of God. And that's the first most tragic thing about it. The second most tragic thing is that it is an oppressed part of our society, a demographic of our society that's marginalized, and we don't, as a society, seem to care a whole lot about it.
We have become numb to the loss of life amongst minority communities because it's happening so frequently that it's just another news cycle.
Yeah.
It's just another sad, unfortunate case. And yet, while some people have become numb, others have become angry.
Yeah.
Outraged and hurt.
And let's talk about, I want to ask you about a quote from Martin Luther King that I've seen.
Yes, sir.
Floating around different places. Attributed to Martin Luther King is the quote, "White Americans must be made to understand the basic motives underlying Negro demonstrations. Many pent-up resentments and latent frustrations are boiling inside the Negro and he must release them. It is not a threat, but a fact of history that if an oppressed people's pent-up emotions are not nonviolently released, they will be violently released." And I've seen that posted a number of times in the last few days, kind of as a means to justify the response of many of the looters and the rioters that are continuing the cycle of violence from the other side of the perspective. Can you talk about that MLK quote?
Sure. Martin Luther King Jr. also said that riots are the language of the unheard. Now, so that was him attempting to explain
the psychology behind it.
Correct.
I don't think it was him endorsing the behavior. It was him explaining the...
His whole movement was centered around nonviolence.
Yes.
This is an individual where the Ku Klux Klan had burned a cross in his yard. They had threatened many threats against him and his family, but his whole movement was nonviolent. But at the same time, he could not ignore the pleas and the outrage of those who wanted to be violent.
And at some point, if the system is not helping you at all,
they feel like the only way they're going to get heard or they're going to get noticed is if they take measures into their own hand.
That's right.
Pastor, while you and I will sit here and we will condone, we will disavow violence and we
can condemn,
as we should, it is also incumbent upon us to realize and to know that if nothing is done, the violence will continue. And it will only become maximized. So when you have hurting people, when you have oppressed people who already feel like they don't have a voice, they're not afraid of dying. They're not afraid.
If I'm going to die at the hands of the system, what
does it matter anyway?
Why does it matter how I die at the hands of the system? Right. Whether it's me minding my own business, or whether me resisting the system, if I'm going to die at the hands of the system either way,
correct,
then what difference does it make which way I do it?
Correct. Correct.
And I don't think any of us that don't have to deal with and there is a serious amount of racial profiling that happens in the system. And those of us that are not those of us that are not falling under those particular demographics, I think we would do many of the exact same things. Correct. if it was our community that was being marginalized, that was being oppressed in that kind of way. We wouldn't put up with it. We wouldn't.
So I'm thankful that I have the gift of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
That enabled us to know right from wrong, good from evil.
Yes.
But I will sit here and be candid with you, Pastor. Absent from the gift, absent from the Holy Ghost, I probably will be doing the same thing.
Yeah.
Because I look at it as that could easily be me.
Yeah.
That could easily be my family member, my neighbor.
And they don't care whether or not you have the Holy Ghost.
Exactly. they're not really interested in hearing you quoting scripture.
They don't care if you're talking in tongues when he has his knee in your neck. It don't matter.
It doesn't matter. Right. And so we are supposed to respond as Christians. Pastor, you're absolutely correct. But we also have a human element to us.
Yeah.
We're not deity, we're flesh. And it's because of that flesh, it's because of my humanity that allows me to feel broken, allows me also to feel outrage and to feel angry over what has happened and what is happening in our nation today.
And, you know,
and it's okay to be angry. I think sometimes we forget that the Bible.
Be angry and sin not.
It is totally rational.
God.
And normal to be angry because God has designed our emotions.
Well,
God has designed the way we feel.
Not only has God designed our emotions, but as divine image bearers, we reflect the emotions of of the God whose image that we bear. And so. Right. And so God himself has, as we know well throughout Scripture, has the capacity for anger. God in the Old Testament has the capacity for anger. Jesus, God incarnate in the New Testament, a little episode known as the temple cleansing, teaches us that God in Christ, has the capacity for anger, and the terrible side of responding with anger and not responding with the gospel, not responding as a Christian, is you end up with a situation like happened in St. Louis, I believe, yesterday with David Dorn.
Yes, very unfortunate. My heart broke, Pastor.
Getting murdered, getting shot down in front of, right on the street, a video of him bleeding out on the street, being shot by looters in St. Louis.
Over TVs
at a pawn shop. And, you know, we're angry about a black man dying wrongfully in George Floyd and many others. He's not the only one. He's just the Correct. Face and the name that we're using at this particular point. There are many others.
Correct.
So we're angry about a black man dying unjustly, and then a black man ends up dying unjustly. Right. That's what happens when you respond in any way other than the gospel.
Right. Correct. And so, and not just, and yes, and we look at it from a moral, spiritual perspective. But there's also the economical perspective, what violence and what looting does to communities, to businesses that are there, that are there to provide for that community, for those individuals.
Yes.
And now those resources are gone. Those resources are depleted. And when those resources are depleted, what do you think that's going to cause? More yes. anger. More yeah. frustration, more desperation. And, you know, I one of the videos I saw was an older Black woman with tears in her eyes because her business was gone.
Yeah.
She's like, this is not the way we do things. She's like, I look just like George Floyd.
Exactly. I look
just like him.
And you're destroying my business. You're destroying my livelihood.
Right.
And there was another young Black lady that put out a passionate video where a Black man had pulled a gun on her and five other Black ladies because they were attacking her business.
Right. Yes. Very unfortunate. And it takes away from the original purpose, from the original intent. It takes away from the life of George Floyd. And I'm very thankful that George Floyd's family have come out and said, violence is not the answer. This is not the way things should be done.
And of course, we're both going to say that kind of response is absolutely wrong from a Christian perspective. Right. But knowing that and feeling like nothing's ever going to be done about it is also an understandable fallen human emotion.
Yes, sir.
And man, I get it. I think if it was my community that was being attacked in that way, like you said, apart from the Holy Spirit, apart from the grace of God, apart from an understanding of the gospel, apart from all of that, if it was the situation was reversed, I would likely do the same thing to defend my family, my community, exactly. my home.
Exactly. And I'm in that same boat as well.
So let's shift from that specifically to just talking about politics in general. You are a conservative Black Republican. I'm assuming that you identify as a Republican. Are you independent? Are you
more so independent? I used to identify as that, but I just identify as a conservative.
Have you, as you stated earlier, you mentioned a George W. Bush quote from yesterday. I saw on Twitter that you spoke about how much you loved George W. Bush.
Yes. I interned for George W. Bush. 2006, during his presidency. What attracted me to George W. Bush, what attracted me to politics in general was the year 2000. I wasn't eligible to vote. I wasn't old enough to vote till 2004. I'll be 35 in October, just for context.
I'll be 45 in August. So.
We're young men. Yeah. We haven't reached the prime of our lives yet. But I never forget my godfather, African-American Pentecostal preacher, randomly out of the blue told me, he says, Demetrius, I would never tell you how to vote, but just because you're Black doesn't mean you have to vote a certain way.
Yeah.
That comment really intrigued me. It really struck a chord in me. So it compelled me to go and do my own research and to look up history. And after I did that, you know, I said, well, I have conservative views socially, economically. My father served in the military for 20 years. We lived in Germany and we lived in Korea. And so I understood the importance of a strong military and a strong national defense. I was attracted to George W. Bush's message of compassionate conservatism. But when 9/11 happened, and I will never forget because I was a junior in high school, and I will never forget how courageous he was in the aftermath of the largest terrorist attack that ever happened on American soil. I will never forget him with the bullhorn, with the firefighters in New York. And they said, we can't hear you. And he said, but I can hear you. And the people, we hear all of us too, how he united the country. Pastor, I'm a huge sports fan. I love the game of baseball. I love its history. I love that it's America's favorite pastime. I love all the culture that comes with baseball. I will never forget game 3 of the 2001 World Series when George W. Bush goes into Yankee Stadium. New York, a very liberal state that did not support him in the election. But he walks out there with the fire department jacket on. And there's American flags waving everywhere. He stands right there on the mound, the pitcher's mound. He throws a strike dead center of the plate. And for a fleeting moment, Americans were unified.
Yeah.
We were ready to
They didn't care that George Bush was a Republican president.
They didn't care. They didn't care. And so there's the presidency of George W. Bush and the man, George W. Bush, and him and his family, and how gracious they are. Just really good people. I'm very appreciative for their contributions to our society.
I'm also a big Cubs fan, a big baseball fan, but a big Cubs fan. So I know you're a Braves fan, right?
I am. I'm a huge Braves fan. But I tell you what, when the Cubs won the World Series, that was good for the country.
It really was. It was good for baseball.
It was.
I have probably, I would say right at 25 autographed baseballs from the 2016 World Series.
Wow. That's impressive.
Quite a bit of other Cubs memorabilia. I was born and raised in Louisiana, so I'm a huge Saints fan, and particularly a huge Drew Brees fan.
He's one of the best. I tell you, man, I still have a little bit of bitterness and animosity towards the Cubs in 2016, only because there's former Braves players on that team that got a ring. Jason Hayward, David Ross, who I believe is the new coach or manager for you guys.
Yeah, David Ross is the new
guy. Great guy, great selection. And I just remember Jason Hayward kind of not doing as much as he could with us. And then, of course, he goes wins a ring with
the Cubs. You know, honestly, he had a terrible year with the Cubs offensively. His numbers were horrible.
Defensively, he's a great presence.
Absolutely. Defensively, he saved, you know, God only knows how many runs he saved, how many games he saved defensively. Right. No doubt about it, a valuable presence. But all of the stories coming out of the clubhouse from Game 7 of the World Series during that rain delay, is that it was Jason Hayward in the dugout that stood up and gave a passionate speech to the team, that when they came out, and obviously won Game 7 in spectacular fashion. But every one of the players on the Cubs team says it was Jason Hayward that
veteran leadership presence.
Yeah. And so, man, I don't care what he did all year long. I don't care how many times he rolled the ball over to second base slowly and ended an inning. I don't care. That he was present defensively and then present in the clubhouse with that inspiring speech that helped them break a 108-year curse.
I have so much respect and admiration for individuals who show up when it matters the most. I think of basketball players like Robert Horry, Derek Fisher. During the regular season, they average what, 2.3 points per game or something small like that. But come playoff time, when the games matter the most, they've hit the biggest shots, game winners of their careers. And there's other people like that as well. So when it matters the most, that's when you get to see true leadership. And as a sports fan, just in life in general, I'm very appreciative of that. You learn a lot from that.
So is Michael Jordan the GOAT?
Oh, but we don't have enough time. There's no argument without controversy.
Controversy, great.
Okay, the GOAT.
Is the mystery of Jordan. The mystery of Michael.
And I say that as someone who grew up watching Jordan. And, you know, the dunks, the tongue out. I mean, just like any kid, I tried to be like Mike. but what I love about Mike is that as a kid, I remember telling my parents when playoff comp time, it's like, I don't know, the Bulls didn't look so great this year. I said, the Bulls are going to win. They have Mike Jordan. They're not going to lose. So you always knew beyond a shadow of a doubt, he's going to come through in the clutch. Yeah.
There was no doubt Michael carried those Bulls teams in the 90s.
Yeah.
But
absolutely.
And, man, in my head, like, it's not even a close second.
Not even close. I could see if it was close.
Yeah.
But it's really not.
even if somebody would say that maybe Michael's Michael Jordan was not the greatest player of all time, you have to say that Jordan had the greatest career of all time.
Yeah. And what's also fascinating is that when he took that brief hiatus from basketball and he went to play baseball, at the age of 31, he hit 200 in the double A's, or single A or double A, I can't remember.
Yeah.
That was a feat within itself.
Yeah, to go from basketball to baseball.
To hit 200. And, of course, yeah. If he would have stayed, the Chicago White Sox would have called him up. But to three-peat twice?
Yeah.
To come out of retirement and three – it's unbelievable. It's a feat that I don't think we'll ever
– No, he's the greatest of all. I think he's the GOAT in terms of player, career, everything.
Agreed, 100%.
Just a hands-down GOAT. And I don't even, like you say, I don't even see how it's even close. I don't see how we can even have a conversation about it, you know, really seriously about anybody else being there.
No.
I am missing sports right now.
I tell you what, sports is good for the country.
It is.
You know, we were just talking basketball, and I was thankful for the documentary, The Last Dance, that highlighted Jordan's 1998 Bulls, just to get our minds off of what's been happening. But what I really like about sports is it's a common denominator amongst us all to be united.
It really is.
And I've been to many sports games, and let me tell you something, there's people there of every race, every background, cheering on the same team or cheering against the same team, whatever the case may be. But it's what brings us together.
And, they do. And I think one of the coolest, most recent examples of what you're saying was George Bush and Ellen DeGeneres.
Yes.
Sitting together at, was it a
Dallas Cowboy game?
Football game.
Yeah.
And how much heat they both took for sitting next to each other. It's just absolutely insane.
That speaks to the cultural divide in our country. I mean, guys, it's a football game.
Yeah.
You know how many times I've been to games with people who disagreed with me politically? Yeah.
Absolutely.
Who cares?
Absolutely. Yeah. And I really respected Ellen, you know, defending her decision to, you know, sit and just hang out with a former president. I mean,
yeah.
I would gladly sit at a ball game and sit next to Barack Obama.
Gladly. Have a burger with him.
And sat with him for 3 hours through a ball game and talk with him.
I want to, if you don't mind, let me share this story about my encounter with former President Bill Clinton. It was in 2016, and I was living in Georgia at the time. And he was coming to do a campaign stop for his wife. And he was in close proximity to where I was. I'm of the perception that if a former president or a current president, for that matter, is close to where you are, go, because it's an opportunity that you may not get again. Not to mention that the power of the Oval Office and what it symbolizes is much bigger than the occupant, and it always will be. So I went, I heard Bill Clinton speak, and he was typical Bill Clinton, charismatic, engaged, and I'm right there at the rope line, and he's coming down, he's shaking hands, and I thought to myself, what am I going to say to him? And then I said, well, he has a pretty good rapport among the Pentecostal church. I just talk about that. And so when he came to me, I had, and granted, there's people there that want to take pictures and everything. We talked for at least 5 minutes about the Pentecostal movement and how appreciative he was of the Pentecostals. And I said, Mr. President, stay close to the Pentecostal church. Stay close to it. Let them continue to speak into your life. It's a moment that I'll be forever thankful for and very appreciative, because, you know, even though there is a difference of political theory and political belief.
Major difference in views with,
right,
with Bill Clinton, with
but he's still a soul. He's still someone that God loves.
Absolutely.
He's still someone God's love. And
he's a divine image bearer. He did a lot of great things for our country.
Right.
The economy was great under Bill Clinton. He might have been living off of Reagan's coattail, who knows, but most people only remember that times were good during Bill Clinton. Absolutely. And there have been many days to where I wish we could have, you could turn the clock back to the middle of the Bill Clinton administration.
Yeah. Well, you know, as someone who interned for 43, as we call it, George W. Yeah. Bush, his love for mankind, something that's just been missing quite some time in our leadership. And, you can't go back into the past. I realize that. I'm just hopeful that this generation, that good, decent people would take upon the mantle of leadership. I'm not just talking about President of the United States, but get involved locally, get involved with the state. You know, the famous statement by Tip O'Neill, all politics is local. That's so very true.
Yeah.
I see so many outraged at what's happening in the White House and on the federal level. They have every right to voice their concern. But then my question would be, are you voting for your county commissioners? Mm-hmm. Are you voting for your mayor? Are you voting for school board? Because believe it or not, that's going to have a more direct impact on you.
On your life than who the president is.
Correct.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And man, it has been a pleasure to talk with you today.
Yes, sir. I've enjoyed it.
Thank you for taking the opportunity to speak with me and to come on Forward Talk. It has indeed been a pleasure.
And yes, sir.
I have cried real tears. I have wept over the injustice that has happened in the last few weeks.
Yes, sir.
We've recognized it at our church. We've prayed over it. We've hopefully responded with a message that's hopeful and gospel centric. And it's amazing to be able to shed tears over the death of a man that you've never met, never heard of until his unjust death appears in the news on social media.
Correct.
And it's tragic. It's awful. And through the gospel, through proper participation in the process, we have to end this type of injustice in the world.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's incumbent upon us to do it.
First of all, as the body of Christ. Second of all, as divine image bearers.
Yes, sir.
We have to speak to it. We have to do everything we can to put an end to it.
Yes, sir. I would agree.
Well, man, I've never met you in person. We have, as far as I know, we've never even been in the same church service, unless it would have been at some point because of the times, which I doubt it.
I've been there many times.
I've been there. I don't think it would have been the years that you were there, just because of our age difference and how old I was whenever I went.
My first because of the times was 2005. So
it would have been before 2005. It would have been in the late 90s. So. But anyway, I've never met you in person, but I love you. Thank you for coming on the show today. Thank you for talking with me, and we'll do it again sometime.
Yes, sir. I hope our paths cross in the future.
How often do you visit Ohio?
If not once a year, once every 2 years. My family lives in Dayton.
Well, I live up near Youngstown. The next time you are up in Ohio, let me know and let's try to connect in person, all right?
I give you a shout. Absolutely, brother.
All right, man. God bless you. Thank you.
God bless you. Be good.